This is episode 121 of the Reading Cove Book Club's podcast. If you're a book lover who may be interested in joining an online book club, please visit our website at thereadingcove.com to learn more about our group. For December 2020, we're discussing The Island of Sea Women by Lisa C. Oh, hi, I'm Millenia in Florida.
Monica in Nebraska.
I'm Roberta in Georgia.
And we're three members of the Reading Cove Book Club here to discuss our group's 241st pick, The Island of Sea Women by Lisa C., which was chosen by our very own Monica in Nebraska. Yay! So we have been discussing this online with the rest of the group, and I still need to, I haven't replied to all the questions yet, still catching up, but this was a good choice. I liked it. What about you guys?
I really enjoyed it. This was actually the genocide that happened here. I was a little bit familiar with, because I studied genocide in college. Mm-hmm. So I was familiar with the events that happened.
I wasn't. I don't recall ever hearing about this.
Me neither.
So it was really good education for me about South Korean history.
Yeah, and some of that I wasn't aware of, like the sea women and kind of their culture and everything. That was new to me. But
exactly.
I mean, I knew they were colonized by Japan and everything, but I did take, there's like a seminar of like hidden genocides. So like genocides that people aren't really aware of. So I was aware of, you know, the schoolyard killing or the 4-3.
4-3 incident.
Incident, yeah.
What about you, Roberta?
Well, this was a reread for me, but it had been so long ago, I really didn't remember much. So it was almost like a new book for me. And I liked it a lot. It was, you know, very emotional, but I learned a lot of things from it, you know, a whole lot of things that I knew very little about South Korea at any time in history. I mean, the only thing I knew was the Korean War and the 38th parallel, but I didn't know much else. So this was very enlightening for me also.
Mm-hmm. Basically, the book is totally from Young Suk's point of view. You know, I probably said this in the group. It took about 200 pages to really hook me.
Wow.
I was reading along and just, it was like, okay, I didn't really know anything about these henyo, I think it's pronounced. I don't know how it's pronounced. I think it is henyo because I was reading and listening to it, you know, alternating.
Oh, you're lucky then, because I don't know how to say any of these things.
I think that's what the narrator said, henyo. But these female divers and the whole cultural difference that the women went out, you know, and dived and supported the family while the husbands took care of the children and kept house.
Let's put it loosely.
Yeah. So I thought that was super interesting. And the fact that they were kind of freaks of nature, having adapted to the cold, being able to hold their breath for so long. And then, you know, when the scientists came to study them after the war, I thought, wow, that's fascinating.
Yeah.
And nowadays, apparently, it's kind of a dying skill because the younger generations aren't interested in doing it. So, you know, they're saying that eventually there won't be any more henyo on Jeju Island. So anyway, let's jump into Young Suk's story. So as I was saying, I wasn't finding her point of view to be, like, I didn't connect with her. It felt more like a textbook. Like, okay, you're learning about the history and the Japanese occupation and the relationship with she and Mija and how her mom, you know, took Mija in and they became friends. But I just didn't feel any emotional connection to it until the 4-3 incident. Then it's like it became a different book to me. Suddenly there was like an emotional gravity that it had lacked before, and her point of view and her narration picked up, you know, had some flavor to it now. And I was riveted. It's like I couldn't put it down after that.
It hooked me when I could tell that she did not have a good relationship with Mija. I'm like, okay, well, what happened there? Because you were like closest sisters and now you act like she doesn't exist. And
but then, that was right at the beginning, right?
When that was, right at the beginning.
Mm-hmm. Good. Well,
and so I'm like, okay, I want to find out what's going on. There was a couple times in the beginning where it kind of lost me and, you know, it's kind of the diving parts and everything. I mean, part of it, like when she got attacked by that squid. Yeah. That was really grippy. And I'm like, oh my gosh.
That's
like,
you mean, really... what's her name? Yuri.
Yuri, yeah. Mm-hmm. I could really feel, you know, I was, my heart rate probably went up. And then I was so angry with them. Because it's like, I mean, yes, they're taking care of the kids, but not really. They're just basically lounging around doing nothing, spending otherwise money on gambling and alcohol, yeah, and whatever. It's like, no, they're earning the money. They don't have to give it to you for alcohol. But I was, that's, I guess, besides the point. But, you know, and then, you know, when Mija was attacked, you know, by the Japanese, kind of protecting young Sook's mother, I was like, I mean, I had to set that down for a minute after that part because it was just so graphic. And mm-hmm. I really liked Mija. And then, you know, when they're getting married, I was like, oh, I hope it's not because Mija's marrying the guy you like. I hope that's not the reason you're mad at her.
Yeah, I was thinking
she
that
can't
too.
Control that.
And I would have, I thought that would have been so cliche and just, I wouldn't have liked it much if that were the reason. But I suspected it was probably going to be something to do with a man.
Yeah.
So I was pleasantly surprised to find that no, actually it wasn't. It was much more than that. So I was happy that there was a lot more substance to,
right. Why are they, you know, and then was the part where you could tell he was violent against her. I'm like, you know, why are they throwing it? That's an extra issue that we really don't need. We're learning so much. We don't need a violent husband. And then I saw where it played in. I'm like, mm-hmm. okay, there's a reason she put it in the story. Okay, good. Because it's like, why just have her beat up by her husband just to be beat up by her husband? It just, there's so much other stuff going on. But then it made sense at the end with her reasoning for not doing anything. But honestly, studying genocide, I never faulted Mija because there was nothing she could do. And like what she said, she goes, would you have risked your husband and your children to save me and mine?
But what I didn't understand was, because I found her, what was seen as betrayal at the time, surprising. It's like, first she offered to hide with them. Like when they announced that relatives of officers or whatever should come forward, and Mija kept quiet, and she thought, she said, you know, maybe I can help you guys if I
she
stay
was there. She and wanted then, to die.
Oh, really?
She wanted to die with them. She didn't say that at the time, but when she's talking about her abusive husband and how then he came through and he goes, I didn't want you to be stuck with this monster of a man. She wanted to die. She didn't want to put up with her husband beating her up anymore. And she's like, well, I can die here with my friend.
Oh, I didn't catch that. Because I was confused when, after she said that and her husband showed up, she didn't even try to help them. That's what confused me. Like, why all of a sudden, you know, you said you were going to stay to help them and then your husband shows up and you don't even make an attempt to help or to take one of her kids or something. So
yeah,
I was surprised by that.
I suspected that, mm-hmm. That she wanted to die in the moment just because I knew she was beat up. Like, okay, I'm just going to die with my friend, but I'm not going to tell her that I'm just, you know, hoping they kill me too.
You're probably right, because she was living in a bit of a nightmare.
Yeah.
And then someone who's read first accounts of genocide and everything that have survived. You know, I read, you know, a woman that hid in like the small room the size of a bathroom, like 20 other women. Mm-hmm. And the person that hit her made her push out her own brother and his friend into the street. And they died right there. And then, and it's like, he's saving all these people, but yet that was such a horrible thing. And it's like, you know, it's so hard to fault people that mm-hmm. are doing something, but then they're also not. And it's just how genocide is. And it's just, so I never did fault her, but I could understand why Young Sook did. So I thought, if I were in Young Sook's position, you need to be angry with somebody.
First of all, it was really over the top to me. It felt over the top. I know maybe things like that really happened, but for his head to get blown off in front of everyone, Junbu, and they cut off Yuri's breasts?
Yeah.
I was like, oh my, what? And then the brutality and the cruelty, it just felt unimaginable. I couldn't even believe it was happening. And there was another horrible thing about a pregnant woman that they like inserted something hot inside her just to see what would happen. The soldiers, I was just like, what? So anyway, it was horrible Christmas reading.
terrible things like that happen. People can be so evil. Maybe.
I'm sure, but it was just like, oh my God, it is Christmas, ring ding ding a ling. And then
that's true.
And then I'm reading this, it just did not mesh.
something light after that.
Yes, I did. I went for some romance novel immediately. Some sappy Christmas book.
It's a very, very heavy book, but I know the Japanese did the Philippines to the Filipinos. Mm-hmm. You know, if they thought they were hiding U.S. POWs, mm-hmm. they tied them up. They stuck dynamite into their feminine regions and blew them up that way. I mean, it's very brutal. I mean, it's, you know, and
savage.
Germans did the same thing to the Italians. Those reprisal killings. So for every one of our Germans that you kill, we're going to kill 10 of you. And, you know, very similar to, you know, the what happened in the schoolyard. And
it's just total savagery. It's like not even human. Yeah. But after all that happened, I feel like she had to have been so traumatized watching her husband die that way, her son and Yuri all at the same time. I mean, what do you do with all of that pain and shock and trauma? So I think she just parked it at Mija's feet.
Yeah.
I mean, it was the easiest thing to do.
She had to blame someone, yeah.
Yeah, it was, you know, she didn't even try. Of course, it wasn't Mija's fault, but given that she didn't make an effort to help, she didn't lift a finger or try anything, I think it made it really easy for Young Suk to just really hate her for it. And then she didn't really hate her, did she? Because, you know, later she had to keep going to her house, you know, and she was taking care of the house.
Yeah.
Of Mija's house. So, yeah, I do think that Lisa C, she's so gifted at showing friendships and the complexity of friendship and pain, because I really felt that, you know, with Young Suk. You could feel how much she loved Mija, but how hurt she was at the same time.
Right.
That she was so hurt that she was willing to cut her own daughter out of her life.
Yeah.
That part really shot me. And as soon as, you know, I read that Clara, and I'm like, oh no, this is her own family that she cut out of her life.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, and that part was a given. I mean, because, you know, her daughter just loves Heidi, the book Heidi. So I'm like, well, if her offspring is named Clara down the road,
yeah.
a couple of generations later, then I know.
Yeah,
it is. And it's just when I realized that it was her own family that was asking about her, and I'm like, oh no, she now is estranged from her family. And then her daughter died of breast cancer, her mm-hmm. granddaughter died of breast cancer, and she didn't even get to meet her. And it's just
no, it was her daughter who died of breast
cancer. It was her daughter,
Young Suk's daughter. Yeah.
Okay.
Her estranged daughter.
And yeah. then it was, because that's where I was getting kind of, okay, now which one was her daughter? Which one was her granddaughter?
Yeah.
And then the
granddaughter we didn't meet. It's the great granddaughter who came to Jeju to talk to her.
And that was Clara.
Yeah.
Okay. Because I thought, yeah, I guess it was her grandma that died of breast cancer. And then, okay. Mm-hmm. So I was trying to connect the family dots. And, you know, and the problem is I'm not familiar with Korean names, and just having all these names that don't mean anything to me just really threw me. Like, well, it might have been better if I was listening to it, because then I could hear how it sounds
right.
while I'm reading. But I didn't have that luxury. So I'm like, I didn't connect with the characters as much. Just,
well, you know, you got to just make up your own pronunciation. That's what yes. I always do. Like, if I see a strange name, I just make up my own way of pronouncing it. Carry on. And I also have to say that I felt like Young Suk, we never see her actually grieve these losses. I feel like she used her anger to mask grieving, to replace yeah. grieving. Because even after she left that town where the massacre happened, and she kind of walked back to her hometown, where her mother-in-law was and her father and whatever, she got there and it's like they say she slept for days out of exhaustion, really. But we never I was kind of waiting to see, how is she going to grieve? You know, we never see her crying, really, or grieving the loss of Junbu or yeah. something. Yeah, so I felt like, gosh, she just stayed angry.
Yep, that was her way of grieving.
Yeah.
Just, she let her anger consume her.
Yes, I feel like at the end, she finally began to show some grief.
Right.
And that's when I started crying. I felt
especially when she, you know, reads all these letters she had never opened before.
Yes, yes. I started crying then.
You know, And then with, you know, realizing about, you know, Clara, why she was named that, mm-hmm. that finally, you know, set her off after all those years being an old lady now that she was finally able to let go.
Yes. When you think about the fact that they never stopped trying to communicate with her.
Right.
They kept sending letters. They never gave up. And I loved that. It's like many people would just react in kind. Oh, you don't want to talk to us? Fine. We don't want to talk to you either. But no, they never gave up.
Which is, you know, sad because she could have, you know, had a much richer life, but that was part of her grief. She couldn't let it go till it was really almost too late. That's what was so emotional too.
She said, there's a quote that I wrote. I need to share it with the group. But she said, I had to hold on to my anger and bitterness as a way of honoring those I'd lost.
Yeah.
And that's so common oftentimes with grief when people lose loved ones. They feel like if they heal and move on, then it's like they've forgotten them.
Right.
Yeah. You know, and I think why she was so hardened, I think just from her past experiences, I mean, watching, she was supposed to look out for Yuri, and I didn't blame her for Yuri. Yuri made her own decision, mm-hmm. but she was blamed for Yuri. And then, you know, with what happened to her mom, I don't want to say she caused her mother to die, but she had somewhat role into that incident and carrying that with her. Mm-hmm. For so long, even just watching her mother die and then watching, you know, what happened to Yuri and not seeing her in that position then mm-hmm. for the rest of her life, knowing, and she blamed herself for that. And yeah. Yuri's mom blamed her, even though she couldn't force her not to go down.
Right.
You know, so, but I think she carried that with her for so long, you know, that even the death of her mother, and it's like,
and I didn't like that. Me. Yeah. And I didn't like that Mija threw it in her face. When she finally confronted Mija about not doing anything, and then Mija throws it in her face about what happened with Yuri and what happened with her mother, I was like, oh, Mija. I know she's blaming you for the death of her husband and stuff, but... And I figured she probably just said it, you know, when you're angry and someone says something hurtful to you, you want to say something hurtful back.
Right.
But I felt like, oh, that was a low blow.
Yeah.
To blame yes. her for her mother's death, you know, and for the way Yuri is now, it's like, come on. It was good.
It was
very heavy read, but I enjoy it. I just can't read too many heavy things
no
at once, just because it weighs on you. And that's why I was like, why are they putting an abusive husband? It's already very heavy. We
don't because there were plenty of abusive husbands. And to think that he raped her the day that same day when they met him.
Right.
He raped Mija.
Yeah, and that's why. And I was like, why is the grandma making Mija marry this guy?
Yes, Young Suk's grandmother, she was horrible. Horrible.
Yes, she kind of orchestrated a lot of this story without even really being present in that much of the story. But just, it's like, wait and see if she's pregnant. If she's pregnant, okay, whatever. But like, she might not even be pregnant. Don't saddle her with this guy. That's horrible.
But she did it deliberately because she had ill feelings against the Japanese and ill feelings against Mija because her father had been a Japanese collaborator.
Right.
I was like, how can you blame her for what her father was doing? That's awful. But I feel like even though Young Suk's mother accepted Mija and took her in when they saw how horribly her aunt and uncle were treating her, I think Mija never felt like one of them.
No.
Not really.
And that's why she didn't see herself in the same light as Young Suk. And even though they were close friends, she was always aware of that divide. You know, I'm the daughter of the Japanese collaborator. And that's why she didn't confide in her when he raped her. She didn't tell Young Suk anything. She told a grandmother.
Yeah, and hear all the time that Young Suk was jealous at first. Mm-hmm. She thought that, you know, he should have been with her, but mm-hmm. she certainly avoided, you know, horrible stuff, because if she'd been with him, who knows what would have happened to her.
Yeah. And I think Mija didn't want to marry him, but the grandmother forced it.
Right.
She felt like that's what she deserved. I think she even told Young Suk that at one point. Like, yeah. Mija deserved it, because whatever. I was like, oh my God, she's awful.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, there's people like
that. Yeah.
And then when you really read about the extent of the abuse after the schoolyard incident, you know, mm-hmm. she was put in the hospital, her hip wasn't right after that. It's like
her husband was angry at her for not trying to save Young Suk and her family that day too. She said that in, I think, in the recording.
Yeah.
That her husband blamed her for that too.
I think even staying there, I think the husband knew she was trying, that was her way of trying to get away from him. Like, okay, so you want to die rather than be with me? Well, I'll give you a reason to want to die.
Want to die.
Yeah. Because it's control.
He was just an asshole. Horrible guy.
Yeah, it is weird because, like, I really didn't like the other husbands that were just lazy, but
I know.
He put that in a whole loo. Compared to him, they were okay. But it's like, I really did not like the husbands. But until I read him, and then I'm like, he was the worst character. I really wanted to just reach through the book and strangle him.
Yeah.
And even the grandmother, even though I respect my elders, it's like, I did not like the grandma. I'm like, it's like so many wasted years when she finally, it's like you lost your best friend.
She was willing to die a lot. She was willing to go to her grave like that. Because if the great granddaughter didn't show up and persist, because she, you know, at the beginning, she had her grandson come and, you know, take her away. And she was trying to avoid her, but they persisted. And then, you know, she was able to play Mija's recording for her. And finally, she began to melt. But I think Young Suk had just resolved to go to her grave like that.
Yeah.
Because she was, you know, a pretty elderly woman by that point.
Right.
And still diving. And the doctor's having to tell her, like, okay, you know. You know, you're not as young as you used to be. Take it easy. And then another thing I have to say that was a little bit distracting at times. So Young Suk's supposed to be illiterate, right? And uneducated. She can't read. She has no education. And her husband, I think, wanted her to get to learn and learn to read and for their daughters to learn to read, which I thought was great. She really had the best husband. In Junggu. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so she's uneducated and illiterate, yet her vocabulary would rival any Harvard graduate. As I'm reading the words that, because this is her narration, her point of view, and she's using words like circumnavigate, cataclysm, studious, and all these huge words. I'm like, okay, is she really supposed to be an illiterate woman?
I think that's Lisa C.
But it's from her point of view.
She's channeling her speaking.
It was really distracting at times. Like, wait a minute. I don't feel like I'm in the head of an illiterate woman. This is a very educated woman.
Yeah, I think authors forget that when they're trying to use a bunch of big words to show how smart they are.
This is why they forget this should have been character. For third person, not first person.
Well, I didn't give it a whole lot of thought. You know, I just overlooked it, suspended disbelief.
Oh my gosh. I thought that was so funny.
Yeah, I noticed that too. Just I'm like, from being in the perspective of someone that's uneducated, I thought it was, you know, but because it wasn't third person narrative, so it was, you know, all the intelligent stuff that the author's putting in there is actually coming from an educated woman. But
exactly.
You know, I enjoy, like, she puts so much research into her books, and I enjoy learning. And see, I thought all of her books take place in China. Apparently, I was wrong. So I was like, oh, Korea, okay. And I really thought it was going to be another book that takes place in China, and it wasn't. So I didn't even know that until I started this book. And I think there's another one that takes place in Cambodia. So,
Really?
Yeah, I think the Tigril of Hummingbird Lane takes place in, like, Cambodia. It's another, it isn't China, it's another Asian country. And she puts so much knowledge, but not into a way where it's like, I'm not reading her research, but she puts it into a story and really makes me want to learn more. And I really, you know, I watched YouTube videos on, you know, the women divers in Korea, just because I want to learn more about it. I was like, that's really fascinating. These are fascinating women. Just neat, like, seeing them, you know, older women going down. And I feel like the beginning part of the book, where you have the old ladies collecting the seaweed and stuff. And I was like, you see them doing that. So it's just, it really comes to life. She does a good job of making you want to learn other cultures. And that's what I like about her, is I learn other cultures and I want to learn more about. I like Lisa C. a lot.
Me too. My favorite book of hers, of course, is Snowflower and the Secret Fan.
Yes.
That one had me bawling too. I do like her writing, so I need to read more.
I do too. I like her, and I'm surprised I haven't read all of her books. Because usually when I like an author, I go and read all of them, and I haven't done that yet. But
I think because maybe they're kind of heavy.
Right.
Yeah. They're very heavy.
They're heavy reads, so it's like you're unlikely to jump right into the next one right after you finish one.
You want to pace yourself.
Yeah, exactly. And then other books get in the way. Oh, really?
Yes. Jodi Picoult's very... I can't do like two in a row from her.
Yeah. I think the overall grade in the group was a B. And one person gave it a C. Wasn't that crazy about it? But everyone else liked it.
Yes. I think it was an overall big hit of the group.
Yeah. I gave it an A minus, I think. Really, it was probably the second best book I read this year.
Wow. I gave it a B plus. I really liked it after 220 pages. That really saved it. I think up until that point, it would have been a C for me.
Yeah, I probably would have been an A if I didn't have those parts where I kind of glossed over. It got a little...
like a textbook. I felt like I was reading a history, world history textbook in the early parts of it. But yeah, later on, it was well worth it. And then one other thing before we go. You remember when Young Sook, I think it was... just before she took over as captain of the diving team or something. And that one woman who was looking sick, they say she might have been pregnant and maybe she killed herself out there in the ocean. I was wondering why Young Sook didn't say anything, because she noticed that she didn't look right before they went out. And then they went out and she never came back.
Do you remember that? And I noticed that because I was thinking maybe that's Lisa C's way of telling us she's sick before she goes out. But that's the problem we run into in first person narrative, is that the person narrating the story is the one that's narrating it and telling it. But really, it's the author kind of inserting that in.
Right.
So it is, because then it throws the story off. Like, well, why didn't you know? And that's kind of what I thought. Maybe it's Lisa C's way of saying, hey, she's sick. But I can't really say that because I'm doing it in first person.
Yeah, so to me it seemed like Young Sook was, she noticed that she didn't look well. Why didn't she speak up and say something? Because then it was like kind of made it obvious something was going to happen. And then she didn't come back.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, that just, I guess, fed into the storyline. I don't know why she wouldn't have said something, but it was just sort of another way to work in a twist.
Yeah, and then the rumors about maybe she was pregnant with Mija's son's child.
Yeah.
Because there were rumors about her and Mija's son or something. And that never really went anywhere. So maybe it wasn't true. I don't know.
That's what I was wondering. I'm like, what happened with that? Because I didn't know. did the author forget that she kind of put that in there? Because I see that in a lot of books where they start to go somewhere and then they completely throw it out, but it's still there. And it's like, well, what kind of happened with this thing?
Yeah,
that
you're like going a loose off end.
And then it's gone.
It's a loose end. But I just ended up thinking it hadn't been true. It wasn't, if she was pregnant, it wasn't his. That's what I ended up thinking. But who knows? Because he was actually involved. He was actually interested in Jun Lee, Young Sook's daughter.
But that doesn't mean he couldn't have gotten somebody else pregnant. So
that's true.
I was wondering, honestly, throughout like the whole thing, I'm like, but did he, it was just one of those, I hate loose ends. And I understand they're writing a lot and they can't remember everything they put in there. But like, that's what your editor's for.
Yeah. You got a
loose end. You kind of started going somewhere on page 135 and then you didn't talk about it again.
Right.
I see it all the time. That's
one
of my reading pet peeves.
Well, I'm glad we read it, and I'm glad the group enjoyed it.
Me too.
Yes. I was like, well, I'll definitely pick one by Lisa C. as one of the choices, because I really like her. And I like picking books I haven't read yet, but I figured with Lisa C., can't go wrong.
Right.
You did a good job there, Monica.
Yes, you did.
People picked the correct one this time.
Yes, it was a good read. It was one I would have read eventually anyway. So glad to read it with you guys so we can talk about it. Okay, so that's our discussion of The Island of Sea Women by Lisa C. We want to thank our listeners, as always, for tuning in. Please leave us your comments below and let us know what you thought of this book. And stay tuned for our next episode. We'll be discussing Little Lost Angel by Michael Quinlan. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.